Jeff Swartz, and I'm the CEO of Timberland. You know, there are wines that come from the places that they're grown, and the five growing regions in France are very distinct by the terroir. The same is true of our brand. I told you that we came from we just want to make shoes to make a living, to, hey, it turns out that we're from a place. There's a provenance to Timberland. And by the Lamprey River in Newmarket, which is a very beautiful place, and this old brick building, and you know, it's a village. It's an American village. It's a very particular place. It's a form of American democracy. It's hard scrabble. It's an immigrant community. It's wet and cold and rough and unforgiving. And our brand, to the extent that any brand can be nurtured from such very stony soil, the truth is, before we knew what our brand was, our brand had a personality and a point of view that was authentic from place. It's funny. We weren't brand builders as instinctively. We were manufacturers. We had an Italian guy come to visit in 1979, who had smelled the essence of the brand. I honestly don't know how he found it, but he showed up in double-breasted suit. My father and uncle thought the guy should be committed, and he said he wanted to buy shoes, and they thought they meant a pair of shoes. And he bought 6,000 pairs of one style shoe, and they made him pay cash because he said he was going to go sell them in Italy, and they thought, okay, when this guy finds out you can't sell shoes in New Hampshire, they're going to come back for his money back, so we'll have to move the offices. Giuseppe sold all 6,000 pairs, and he came back, and he said, I want to create a distributor's business in Italy. And they said, when we figure out what a distributor is, we'll call you back. But he built our brand in Italy. And when we tell you who we are, we used to take pictures of the boot. We'd try to correct every imperfection in color, perfect. Giuseppe took black and white photos of the boots, took the laces out, covered them with mud, hung them from a clothesline, and ran an ad in Italian that said, and thank God neither my father nor my uncle understood Italian. So if you love me, you'll treat me badly. And so I got the ad translated, like, what the hell is he talking about? Well, he wasn't selling boots. He was selling New England rough spirit, independence, and romance, and all of a sudden we had a brand. We used to be a product, so we talk about boot, brand, and belief. Giuseppe, in very many ways, invented the brand. Now, we're smart guys, we're fast learners. And so when we saw that there was value in brand, not in product, we didn't give up the passion for product, but we sure started making investments in brand. So far today, I think I've probably made 10. We're not formally trained. I went to business school. I'm overeducated, but undertrained. And so brand has been to us egocentric and personal and passion. And so we've disdained competitors when we should have paid attention. We've misunderstood consumers when we should have been listening, we were talking. We've been, the best things we've ever done in terms of brand building is listen. And I don't mean to consumers, we're not Procter & Gamble sophisticated. But I told you the story of Giuseppe. He came to us and said, it's not a boot, it's a brand. And we said, got it. We're pretty fully involved, pretty passionate guys about what we do, boot, brand, and belief. And we're so busy, and I don't mean in a temporal sense, but I mean a passionate sense, that we don't know what we don't know. When we forget that, we screw up the brand, we screw up the business, we screw up everything. When we remember that we know what we know and we don't what we don't, and we are powerful enough to say to people, show us, help us, you know, share strength with us, we can fly. And in the 30 years of brand building, the brand is as good as it is, mostly because we didn't know, and we knew that we didn't. Most of the mistakes we've made is when we said, I got this one. And I'm not trying to be, you know, aw shucks from the country, because that's not how I think about us. I'm just telling you the model of almost stone soup, everybody contributing something to make it work, is really how the brand got built. Our brand appears to me strongest when we are at our most vulnerable. 1994, when I was first put in charge of the company, I led us right off a cliff, like one of those Roadrunner commercials. You know, remember those cartoons where the guy's hanging him, and he's like, uh-oh, right? I set the company to grow up 72% in revenue, and it grew 56% in revenue. 56 would have been great, except I set up for 72, and the rest of it went into inventory. We had a liquidity crisis, and we couldn't advertise. We couldn't do anything. We could hardly breathe. The banks were on our, literally, they had our throat for 18 months. And we found the strength of the brand in our weakness, because the consumer didn't notice the distress. In the current cycle, we had a tremendous cycle of consumer interest and then disinterest in the brand. And so we we went out into the market with this, like, oh, I'm not going to want to hear this. And we asked, you know, a million consumers, tell us about the brand. Not literally, we did some real research. And they came back and they said, look, you obviously have your head up your rear end. I don't know what's bothering you, but our view of the brand is, get over yourself. We love the brand. Show up again. Where have you been? And so the permission that we have from consumers has saved us more than once. And when things are really good, we should be smart enough. When or if things are really good again, we should be smart enough not to miss the point that at the end of the day, it is about people making a choice. That no one needs our product. Either they love it or they just don't buy it. And the fact is, even as badly as some things have gone in the last 20 years, consumers have decided to love our brand, and we're grateful. We didn't know what hip-hop was, what it meant, or what it represented. And so after the fact, I mean, long after the train left the station, what people said to us, you know, young people are wearing the boots. We thought, yeah, the young Con Edison guy. No. 16, 18-year-old kids are wearing the boot as a fashion statement. They're not lacing it up. What do you mean they're not? Their feet get wet if they don't lace up their boot. I mean, I don't mean to sound like I fell off a turnip truck, but I'm telling you, until 1994, 95, we had no idea. Now, I'm not proud of that. I'm just telling you the truth. How did that consumer decide our brand was valuable? The postmortem says, you showed respect because you were in the neighborhoods where we live and work. You made a product without compromise, meaning it was tougher than the rest, as the Bruce Springsteen song goes. And you did fine until you decided you were cool. When you decided you were cool, now we are now an element of hip-hop culture. And so now we have to add colors and fancy styles. And the consumer said back, if we wanted colors and styles, we wouldn't have bought you in the first place. Stop doing this. And we said, you know, it's working. And our sales were way up, and we were rocking and rolling, and we were believing that we were cool. And the truth is, the only thing that isn't cool is when you try to be, so I'm told. When we were authentically who we are, we make the best damn boot in the whole world, we guarantee it for life, and it won't disappoint you. Consumer came to us and said, that's respectful and we appreciate it. But if you want to make it cool, hey, look in the mirror, that ain't you. And we didn't listen. And the last 5 years has been that cycle of boom and now bust against that consumer. Not against that consumer in terms of values, meaning the hip-hop consumer, as best I understand it, continues to believe in the authentic things we do. They were put off by our attempt to be topical and cool. I don't know about Jay-Z, Mr. Sean Carter. I don't know what it would take to get him to wear a pair of Timberland boots again. I don't know if he wants to. I don't know what it would do for our brand if he did. He's a very influential guy. But the truth is, that's never been our strategy. Our strategy's been about put your head down and make something so good that they got to have it. Who's they? Well, we think about different consumers all the time. Men, women, children. Would we like to do business with a hip-hop consumer? Boy, young people with the energy of that movement, music and culture, they're a deeply important part of the fashion scene, and we're going to work humbly and hard to earn their trust. There are things we can do. I've got a page in my notebook that's called Culture, and I try to update it every week, meaning I carry this little notebook, and I try to think of different ways to approach the question of scale, because you know, the Godfather was right about just about everything, but he got it wrong when he said the equivalent of it is nothing personal, it's just business. You know, that line from Springsteen, at the end of every hard-earned day, people find some reason to believe. I don't want to have to wait to the end of the day to cast about for, like, what was today all about? And so, yeah, we have businesses at Timberland. We own a brand called Smart Wool in Colorado. There's 72 people there in one building in Steamboat Springs. And real line of sight. People are connected. They know each other's story. Harder to do with 5,000. I can't know people's story the same way. And it can't be about me anyways. But it has to be about a culture where people do want to know your name and they do want to hear your story. And in a funny way, we've really succeeded in that regard. We've really succeeded in creating an active citizenship at Timberland where I may not know your name. I know you know mine because of who I am, but you don't know me either. But it doesn't matter because if you're in pain or if you're in confusion, you have real relationships around your desk or your community. It is part of the ethic of it's we don't live in Newmarket anymore. We're in Stratham, New Hampshire now, just down the road. But that ethic of town meeting and that ethic of speaking truth to power and asking questions and demanding acknowledgement as a human, it's still a very big part of our culture. Look, I do town meetings with pretty high regularity, sometimes video, sometimes in person. Cultures are different. When I go to Japan to do the town meeting, I know that I got to have five questions planted, because no one's going to ask the first question. And I got to have one criticism planted, and everybody will look around, and then all that. Jeff planted the criticism. But then they remember, oh, yeah, that's right. It's okay to ask those kind of questions. And so it takes 2 hours to do a one-hour meeting in Japan because I just got to give them a chance to live in their culture. But I got to spend the 2 hours because otherwise we end up being a big company, and that would be no fun. We have three elements of our strategic plan. One is build brand heat and height. You can get people to wrap it back at you. Everybody in the warehouse in California can tell me, number one, brand heat and brand height. Okay, but what does that mean in your day? What are you doing differently today than yesterday? And they think, I'm in the warehouse. What does that have to do with brand heat and brand height? And so, and they are, by the way, the reason that our brand is only so cool and so successful is because there's a lot that they can be doing. And they have power and strength and insight and genius, but we're not calling on it because there's a gap between concept and execution. And so taking it down to the desktop, to me, that is the what iTunes allows you to do, which is to reach in and bring it right down to your personal device. That's we got to find a way from a management perspective to take the highest concept and drill it down to the most concrete place 5,000 times and 5,000 people, and then regularly update it. People have to be connected to the mission to care about it. The best example I can give you is there was a guy who came to Timberland from the pedigreed world, and he grew up in our treasury department. So it's analytical and powerful and rigorous. And about 12 years into it, I realized that there's a real human being in the treasurer's office. And so I went down his office one day and I said, here's a strange one. He goes, go ahead. I said, I'd like you to run sales and marketing for us outside the United States. And he didn't even laugh because he's like, come on, what are you doing in my office? And I said, no, I'm dead serious about it. We've been through five really pedigreed sales and marketing internationalists, like avec l'accent aigu, perfect, yeah, right? I got a British guy, I got an Italian guy, I got a Chinese guy, and they all flamed out. And so he said, I've never been outside the United States on Timberland business ever. I said, perfect, but I trust you. The team trusts you. You're a for real smart guy. We'll figure this out. Let's make a slow transition. It'll take a year. You travel with me every month to Europe for a year until we're ready. 6 months into it, he says to me, I got it. Not like I got it, I'm dead, but I got it cold. He said, you're right. They trust me. I trust them back. We can do this. He was the best international guy we ever had in the history of the company, except for me, because I did it before him. But for real executives, he killed it. And he had zero experience, but he had intellectual model, he had integrity, he had respect in the organization, he could work the levers. The undervaluing the strength of culture is a failure that I got to remind myself not to make. We do need external talent. We need to bring in diverse points of view, but we also need to recognize there's an incredible ownership class at Timberland of people who they absolutely give a darn, which is not like standard operating procedure. It's cool. And we need to honor that, which means invest in training folks. We haven't done enough of that. We're a place where, like, figure it out. We got things to do. We're becoming more self-conscious about the need to invest in talent because we value the strength of our culture. I can give you examples of really powerful professionals who've been successful in other organizations in the same function who come to Timberland. I'll give you, for instance, of a guy who was successful despite it. He came to Timberland from Pepsi. He was trained in their finance organization, and that's world class. I mean, it's the best of the best. And he said to me about 6 months into the job, or maybe 9 months into the job, he said, I'm not sure I'm going to stay. And I said, what? And he said, you know, at Pepsi, they teach us institutional thoughts, right? So there's a way to do things, is the Pepsi way. And he said, I brought that with me. That's what you wanted, right? I said, yeah, yeah. And he said, and I keep trying to fit it in here, and it's really clear to me that there are elements of the Pepsi way which are right that won't work here. And so he said, I'm faced with a choice. Will I reinvent my, he called it a mind map. Will I reinvent my mind map? Is it worth it enough to me to do that? Or should I go somewhere else where they won't require me to reinvent the mind map, but they'll simply value it? Pepsi's finance organization is an up or out organization. So they have 50 people for every 10 slots, 50 capable people, so they know 40 of them are leaving. Right? And so people circle around like suckerfish around White Plains, and it's a well-trod path. You get great finance people out of Pepsi. We got this guy. And so he said most of the Pepsi alumni go to places where people say, tell us what to do, boss. Right? We'll do it your way. That's what we hired you for. He said, you guys are like stiff-necked Yankees up here in New Hampshire, and I see strength in it, but it's a big ask. You're asking me to sort of reinvent myself, and I'm not sure I want to do it. I'm listening very politely. And so 3-4 months went by, and he came back and he said, what do you think? And I said, I see you kind of twisting and turning, and it's amazing, and I appreciate it very much. And he had, but it hits the second part of your question, because that was on him. It wasn't like he came to Timberland and I said, hey, I recognize the power of our culture, and so let me help you with this transition. It was like, there's the swimming pool, good luck. And his strength was, in the swimming pool, he realized I'm swimming in jello, not water, and so if I want to not drown, I'm going to have to put on floaties. And he did. So he was successful. He chose to leave the company in the end, and his professionalism and his strength is missed. He was a very, very, very capable guy. And so we couldn't retain him. He didn't fail. We couldn't retain him. I learned a lot from that about bringing executives at that level to the company, because the power of their pedigree is they know what to do, or at least they know what they think they're supposed to do. We have to spend different kind of time helping people succeed in our culture. And so we have 2 or 3 new executives that are joining in this 60 days, and we have a very, very concentrated effort against making our culture transparent to them so that they can bring their skills and strengths against not hidden traps and ambushes. So we hope that the process, which I learned much from this guy, we can leverage what we learned from him. I guess it depends what the stakeholder's point of view is. If you're an employee, sustainable means that they will be humble and powerful and excellent, and they'll adapt, and I'll keep my job, and I'll build a career, and I can count on that. Not count on that as, you know, Japanese, but count on that as long as I do my part in this relationship, they'll do theirs. Unsustainable is let's get excited about some really bad idea. Let's convince ourselves we're right. Let's not listen. Let's power down the path and let's fire you for my decision. That's not sustainable. And so if you're an employee as a stakeholder, sustainable is better than not. If you're a consumer, sustainable is important, both from a product perspective and from an environmental perspective. If you're a shareholder, I don't know about that, to tell you the truth, because despite all the conversation about social responsibility investment, it doesn't show up from my perspective. And so most of our shareholders are predicated on knowing when it's no longer sustainable. Most of the people who do business in Timberland stock or anybody's stock do it on the basis I buy it before you know what it's worth, and I sell it before you know what it's worth. And so it's absolutely not a sustainable notion. What's sustainable there is I know something you don't know. I have an insight you don't have. And so if Timberland is consistent and predictable, that takes the fun out of it for the folks that invest in turning over their positions. So with the exception of the shareholder, on the level of financial results, sustainable seems to me an all-win, no-loss proposition. The way the shareholder values sustainable is if we can generate a return for it. So if we can create a culture where the men and women who are Timberland are committed to it, not just in loyal terms, but in engagement terms, we'll be more innovative than our competitors. If we can create products that are more innovative than our competitors and find ways through different media strategies, which is innovative again, to make the consumer care about Earthkeeper footwear from Timberland, then we'll outsell our competitors. And then our shareholders will say sustainable is interesting to us insofar as it generates superior returns. I don't believe that the enlightened shareholder is at hand yet. The enlightened consumer is much closer to hand than the enlightened shareholder. And so my view of that is, Bill Clinton said this once, he said, the world's made of yes, no, and maybe. Spend just the minimum amount of time with yes you need to feel reinforced, ignore no, and focus everything on maybe. And so if the shareholder's view is like, whatever, then my view is fight with the consumer. The conversation is, if I can convince you that Mountain Athletic, lighter, faster, further, sexier, and green, is a unique proposition and you will buy our trail running shoes, not North Faces, the shareholder will think, whatever you're doing, you keep doing it. And I sound borderline cynical there. I'm surely skeptical. I think the shareholder is going to get, the shareholder should have woken up by now, but they haven't. I saw something on Twitter about bottled water or something like that, and our team made the mistake of letting me do Twitter. And so I can like get around my handlers. And so I just blasted a note, said, I'm getting rid of bottled water. I can't solve the world's universe's problems right this minute, but it makes no sense for our employees to be buying bottled water. They don't, and no, it's not Big Brother, it's none of that crap. I'm just telling you, I can give our employees a raise by banning bottled water. And so I thought that would be cool, and I'd be hip, and my kids would be impressed. None of it worked. Everybody's like, what the hell are you doing? I like my bottled water. What about the soda machines? Like, oh, for crying out loud. So then I got the equivalent of the daycare team together. I said, will you guys, since I've said we're going to do this, will you make me look not stupid and make it happen? And they got together, and they wailed away at it, and we made bottled water go away. And everyone at Timberland thinks it's a pain in the neck. Everyone at Timberland thinks it's kind of cool. And everybody at Timberland thinks, knows, they know, Victoria, that something big is coming. And it wasn't bottled water. Bottled water was an exemplar that said, the status quo sucks, and we need to challenge it. Existentially, politically, spiritually, practically, professionally, good enough ain't good enough. It's time to rock it up a little bit. And so, okay, I'm going to ban smoking next to Timberland. People now go outside to smoke. I'm saying, I'm going to post armed guards, shoot them, no cigarette smoking, because I watch the government just bludgeoning to death this notion of healthcare. In the meantime, I'm paying for healthcare at Timberland. We're self-insured, and people in our community are smoking cigarettes, and you and I are paying for it if you were a Timberland person. So I, like, no, come on, back to the ownership mentality. No riders on the storm here. We're going to differentiate healthcare rates at Timberland. If you take care of yourself, you get one rate. If you don't take care of yourself, look, this is America. We're not telling you what to do, but we're going to create incentives or disincentives because, hey, come on, we're not getting any younger here. In baseball, when they bring in the relief pitcher, they say the starting pitcher is responsible for the runners. I'm responsible for the runners at Timberland. And you're not a baseball fan, but by that, I mean, look, I've been working at Timber for 20, almost 5 years now. That's a lot of product in the marketplace. A lot of promises made to consumers. I own those. Now, not like Captain Queeg. I don't mean to, so I said failures, not successes. If you want to come be the CEO of Timberland, which, by the way, would suit the stock market and me and my family, you can come right now and be the CEO of Timberland. Every success that comes from tomorrow is yours, right? But every failure, the trails, a boot that gets returned because it didn't work, an employee who lost their job, I own every single one of those failures forever. They don't go away, right? When XYZ lays off 10,000 people and then next week hires 10,000 people, it's not the same 10,000 people. Even if it was the same 10,000 people, you can't undo the injury you did to somebody. You can't. What's the accountability of the CEO? Cows in a feedlot that are chewing on grass, destined to become hamburger. A derivative product from that will be leather. The methane emissions from the cow are my accountability. When someone slips on a piece of ice in outer Afghanistan with a pair of boots that you bought third hand that says Timberland on it, I'm not arguing legal responsibility. I'm saying to you, morally, I put this thing in motion. I'm the third generation of my family to do this. The accountability of the CEO, you own it, baby. It's not Sarbanes-Oxley. Sarbanes-Oxley is like a Band-Aid after the fact. When the accountability, I have the names in my desk in the middle left-hand drawer of everybody that's left Timberland in the last 18 months, most of whom didn't leave voluntarily. Some people lost their jobs because I didn't do a good enough job running the company. I keep the names on the list. By the way, that's my problem, not theirs. There's no comfort to them that their name's on my desk. I keep the list there because I'm accountable for those failures, and I don't want to replicate those mistakes. And being the CEO, you own that, period. We have all sorts of competitive challenges. Nike is a big, hairy beast from the West Coast. Along the line in my career, there's been incredible reinventions of the business model. The folks from Inditex that own Zara from Spain have reinvented. like Uniqlo in Japan reinvented apparel retailing one step towards fast. Then along came czar and made it really fast, and folks like H&M are doing that. Now, so far, they haven't done that to the shoe business per se, but it used to be good idea, good shoe, take your time, everything will be fine. Along came brands like Zara, who said, we're going to do that so fast your head will spin off your shoulders. So competitive challenges, I've seen reinventions of the marketplace of real consequence in 25 years. And all I know is it took 38 years for 50 million people to use radio in the United States. And Facebook had 100 million users or whatever it was in a year. And so all I learned from those statistics is whatever we think the competitive threat of the moment is, we better deploy some people to think about tomorrow's threat, because the pace of danger to our business model is higher now than it was when we started, and we can barely cope with the one we got. And so I would call that broad frame the business model itself. That's not a particular competitor, so their shoes are better than ours. It's their idea of how to do business, not what to do, but how to do it. To me, that's an existential threat to all our businesses, surely to ours. I've also made tremendous mistakes with consumers. We've talked about that. But I made the most sort of profound failure was with this consumer who wanted to be treated with authenticity and simple, and we made it complicated, and we had a big business, and then we didn't have a big business. And that's a failure that's mine. I guess the one that bothers me the most, which is neither of those two, although both of them bother me a lot, is the consequence of those kind of failures is there's loss in business. There are relationships that you set out to create and you fail to consummate, and you leave behind loss. And that's something that that's the hardest part of what this job is for me. If you read our code of conduct, which is the rules by which other companies employ people on our behalf. So in China or Vietnam or in Portugal, if you want to make Timberland shoes in somebody else's factory or apparel, our code of conduct says we will not permit an employee to work, your employee to work more than 60, we will not allow you to have an employee of yours work more than 60 hours during a work week, in a consecutive work week. Now, if you read the codes of all our competitors, good companies, they say no more than 60 hours in any given work week, except at peak times, because it's a, you know, business is seasonal, right? And so the problem with that is it's hogwash, because we have to define our terms. So since we've said peak time and haven't said more, then if you want to work 120 hours in a factory, you know, 6 months out of the year, you just call it peak time. Now there's a dilemma, boss, because we pay more as a result. We have to have more people in the factory. We have to flex the factory up and down harder than the other guy does. And the factory owners say to me, you're not doing the right thing. We say you have to be 16 to work in a Timberland factory anywhere in the world, not our factory, but somebody else's factory, making our stuff. They say, but the law here says 15. And we say, I heard you. And if it sounds like the Imperial American from New Hampshire, you got to live with me, fellas, because I can't live with me otherwise. We've done work on this. This is what we believe is right. And so it's not an ethical challenge in the sense of should we or shouldn't we, but it plays out as like, these guys ain't easy to do business with. Or this insistence of a point of view creates tension, and it's real. A clear sense of mortality and a deep sense of fear that for all the rhetoric, got very little to show for it. The love of a father for his children is different than the love of a husband for his wife, of a congregant for his God. But I have the joy of all of those, and it's not like pornography. Like I'll tell you when I find it, it's almost palpable. It's almost sensory. There is an unconditionalness to the love that I pray would become the standard for the love of every parent for his or her child. Not unconditional in a blind sense, but unconditional in a. It comes from an infinite place, and it's inexhaustible. The love of a husband for his wife is a mixture of awe and fear and joy, and the love of the congregant for the divine is silent and stupefied and breathless and so overwhelming that it's that it goes beyond words. I'm wearing smart wool socks. I'm wearing Timberland shoes and Timberland pants. You're gonna laugh because it was a New York day. So I'm wearing a Zegna blazer. I know this is a Brioni shirt. Don't laugh at me. My wife got it for me. And I'm wearing, these are some Danish kind of glasses. I don't know who they are. I got a Red Sox hat here because we gotta carry the colors. And I'm wearing a watch that, I don't know what brand it is. I don't even know if it has a brand. It's a cheap old watch, but it was given to me by a man whose son died when he was wearing it. And so I don't know what brand it is, but he asked me to wear it to remember the sacrifice that others make so that we can be free.